In the first part of today's worship, we heard the story of Jacob dreaming about a staircase to heaven. This happens just as Jacob is running away from home. A reminder that God is with him wherever he goes. Jacob escapes to his uncle's home. Lots happen there. He spends a lot longer than he expected. Years go by. There's so many struggles that he faces that he eventually runs away from his uncle too. Now, as a much older man, Jacob is returning home. He's scared about what how his brother Esau will receive him. And in this time, all this time, they haven't spoken. And now, just like the time when he ran away, Jacob finds himself sleeping alone outside. And again, an angel appears to him, but not as a dream this time. The angel wrestles with him all night long. At least we think it's an angel. Scripture says it's a man, but Jacob sees himself as wrestling with God. Jacob refuses to let go unless this supernatural being blesses him. The angel wounds Jacob in his hip socket, giving Jacob a permanent limp. Even still, Jacob holds on. Eventually, the man, angel, God thing relents and agrees to bless Jacob. Jacob's given a new name, Israel. He's a changed man after that. One of my all-time favorite plays is Angels in America. HBO made it into a mini-series with Meryl Streep and Emma Thompson. It's 6 hours of queer religious poetry, and it centers around the story of Jacob wrestling the angel. Just for fun, I'm going to play one of its final scenes where the main character, who is dying of AIDS in the hospital, wrestles with the angel, who is Emma Thompson, and refuses to let go until she blesses him. And while that is playing, we're going to be listening to today's scripture reading, which comes from Genesis 33, verses 22 to 31.
Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him until daybreak. When the man saw that he did not prevail against Jacob, he struck him on the hip socket, and Jacob's hip was put out of joint as he wrestled with him. Then he said, "Let me go, for the day is breaking." But Jacob said, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." So he said to him, "What is your name?" And he said, "Jacob." Then the man said, "You shall no longer be called Jacob, but Israel, for you have striven with God and with humans and have prevailed." Then Jacob asked him, "Please tell me your name." But he said, "Why is it that you ask my name?" And there he blessed him. So Jacob called the place Peniel, saying, "For I have seen God face to face, and yet my life is preserved." The sun rose upon him as he passed Peniel, limping because of his hip.
This is such a dramatic story that lends itself so easily to art and poetry. Lots of famous paintings have depicted Jacob wrestling the angel. Through biblical scholar Theodore W. Jennings Jr., I learned this week about this piece by Jacob Epstein. Most other classic art depicts Jacob in the midst of wrestling, like an angel or a Greek or Roman gymnast. Epstein's sculpture here, though, shows what it might look like after the fight is over. Jacob is wounded and exhausted and collapses in the angel's arms. This was made in the 1940s, and it was scandalous. The intimacy and fleshiness of this sculpture made people very uncomfortable. But that's precisely why it's such a great depiction of the story. Jacob has an intimate encounter with the divine. It is passionate, igniting all of the passions. Anger and eroticism, tenderness and toughness, weakness and strength, confusion and certainty. If you wrestle with God, expect a cacophony of emotions and desires. Expect that you can't win, but you can't stop. Expect that you will get hurt. Expect that you will change. Jacob is changed by this. He's given a new name, Israel, and he will forever limp. As Christians, when we talk about having an encounter with God, a personal experience of our Lord Jesus Christ, being filled with the Holy Spirit, however it is you describe it, In our minds, it's a powerful but gentle experience. It's loving and healing, transforming and beautiful. All of that's true, I don't want to deny it. But what the story of Jacob shows is that encountering God is also bizarre and terrifying and intimately passionate and leaves you bruised. Here's another scene from Angels in America that describes what wrestling with God might feel like.
I had a book of Bible stories when I was a kid. And that was this picture I'd look at 20 times every day. Jacob wrestles with the angel. I don't really remember the story or why the wrestling. Just the picture. Jacob is young and very strong. And the angel is a beautiful man with golden hair and wings, of course. I still dream about it many nights. And to me, in that struggle, fierce and unfair, the angel's not human and it holds nothing back. So how could anyone human win? What kind of a fight is that? It's not just. Soul thrown down in the dust, your heart torn out from God's, but you can't not lose.
Soul thrown down in the dust, your heart torn out from God's, but you can't not lose. This is the human struggle. This is the struggle of life itself. Our struggle with our Creator and with our creation. We are all wrestling with life, with our relationships, with work and vocation, with knowing who we are and what we should do, with pain and grief and joy and hope. Nothing comes easy. It is a struggle, a wrestle for each of us. And ultimately, we're wrestling with God. It is important, it is sacred, to acknowledge that your relationship with the divine is not just sunshine and happiness. It is in the darkness and saddest nights that God is with you. Sometimes as an arm around your shoulder, and sometimes flipping you over and tossing you to the ground. That, too, is God at work. Beatnik poet Allen Ginsberg became famous with his poem Howl. In it, he looks at his generation of young people from the 1950s and howls at the pain and ugliness of society. It's a long poem in three parts that is filled with vivid imagery of the ugly side of North America, painful and dark. My favorite part, though, is the footnote. It's a separate poem that, in your mind, should be read along the whole length of Howl. And in the footnote, he says, "Holy, holy, holy," repeatedly. He calls everything holy, even the ugliest things. It's this contradiction of sacred beauty in the mud and grime. It's a contradiction like the existence of humanity itself, dirt beings filled with the breath of God. I'm going to play you the first part of Ginsberg reading the footnote to Howl. There is a bad word in it, just to warn you. But I want you to hear him reading it, because you can hear in his voice the mix of sacredness and pain.
Holy, 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 holy. The world is holy, the soul is holy, the skin is holy, the nose is holy, the tongue and cock and hand and asshole holy. Everything is holy, everybody is holy, everywhere is holy. Every day is an eternity, every man's an angel. The bum is holy as a seraphim. The madman is holy as you, my soul, are holy.
To be holy is to be sacred and set apart for God. But what in creation could be set apart from God? God is everywhere. In the slums and the mountaintops, in prison cells and palaces, in your poverty and your abundance, all of it holy. It reminds me of Leonard Cohen's song, Hallelujah. Anyone who performs that song with a smile just doesn't get it. This isn't a happy song. This is a cold and broken hallelujah. The type of hallelujah that happens when you wrestle with God. But why wrestle? Jacob had been through enough already. Why did God appear to him that way? Why did God need to make him struggle more? Why does God make us struggle? Why put us through so much pain? Because this is how we change. This is how we grow. It's not pretty. It's not meant to be pretty. It's real. Jacob returns home a changed man. He had struggled with his uncle, but God shows that he also struggled with himself and with divinity. He becomes a new man with a new name and a limp to show for it. It's how change happens with us too. It's not pretty or easy. And if it's going to be worth it, you're going to have to fight for it. God will make you fight for it. It hurts. Let's listen again to a scene from Angels in America. In this one, a mannequin comes to life and explains how people change.
Bitter Lady of the Plains, talk to me. Tell me what to do, I'm stuck. My heart's an anchor. Oh, wow. Look. The magic of a theater or something.
Look at you. So perfect in place.
The desert, the mountains, the previous century. Maybe I could have believed in you then. Maybe we should never have moved east. Was it a hard thing to do, crossing the prairies?
You ain't stupid, so don't ask stupid. Ask something for real.
In your experience of the world, how do people change?
Well, it has something to do with God, so it's not very nice. God splits the skin with a jagged thumbnail from throat to belly, then plunges a huge, filthy hand in. He grabs hold of your bloody tubes, and they slip to evade his grasp, but he squeezes hard, he insists. He pulls and pulls, till all your innards are yanked out. And the pain, you can't even talk about that. And then he stuffs them back, dirty, tangled, torn. It's up to you to do the stitching.
Get up and walk around.
Just mangled guts pretending.
Yeah. That's how people change.
We're all just mangled guts pretending, aren't we? All of us limping like Jacob, carrying our wounds and our scars, proof that we have overcome, proof of blessing. Our society is going through a moment right now where our guts have been ripped out from us. The pandemic and the politics of this pandemic, the reckoning of systemic racism, the potential collapse of our economy, these are ugly and painful things, things worth howling about. It's like God has shoulder-checked society and thrown us down. We're trying to catch our breath while being pinned to the ground. But as awful as it is also beautiful, because it is in that struggle that we will change. We will strive, we will grow. It's only through this pain that we could have the hope that things might be different. And the same is true for you individually. I know a lot of you are going through some terrible times. I know how much you struggle to keep going. You're already pinned down and you wonder how much more God can throw on top of you. You can't win, but you can't give up. You cling on fiercely, not letting go until you are blessed, until you are changed, until the day that God makes you new. It feels like your guts are all spilt out there, doesn't it? And after it's done, you're going to be left to stitch yourself back together alone. But you'll survive. You'll be renewed. You'll have scars that you'll come to be proud of, proof of an old life left behind and a promise of a new future. So hold on. Don't let go of that angel. The night is still young and you're going to be tossed around a few more times. It will hurt. It will excite. It will arouse. It will exhaust you. But you will survive. You will be made new. There will come a moment when God will hold you like the angel held Jacob, and you will see God face to face. Amen. Instead of praying with you today, I'm going to invite you to take some time this week to pray a wrestling prayer with God. What you do is you take whatever it is that's bothering you in life, whatever is frustrating you, causing pain, making you scream. I want you to take that and throw it at God. Pick it up, scream at it, throw it as hard as you can right at God. Take all of that anger and pain you feel, ball it up into your fist, and punch towards heaven. Take a moment today or later this week to give God hell, to wrestle God down, to yell and kick and jujitsu the divine. God can handle it. Trust me, there's nothing you could say that could hurt God. Prayer is the safest space in which you can really vent. Let God know how angry and disappointed you are. Give God a good lecture. You'll be wrong. This is one fight that you'll never win. But it'll feel so good. And when you're done, when you collapse exhausted, God will be there to pick you up and hold you, like the angel held Jacob. Yelling at God is still talking with God. It is still prayer and it's still holy. I can't do that yelling for you. I've got my own things to be yelling about. So I'm going to leave that in your hands. That's your homework for today. Okay? I end now with a blessing from 1 Kings chapter 8. Blessed be the Lord, who has given rest to his people Israel, according to all that he has promised. Not one word has failed of all his good promise, which he spoke through his servant Moses. The Lord our God be with us as he was with our ancestors. May he not leave us or abandon us, but incline our hearts to him, to walk in all his ways, and to keep his commandments. Amen.